And I pointed out that there is a fundamental issue that faces the entire legislative judicial process today, and that is the issue of interpretation, same issue that you face in much of theology, and that is, do you interpret the Bible literally, historically, and grammatically as the writers intended, or do we assign some new meaning to the text that it did not even enter the thinking of the original writers? With the advent of liberal philosophy and theology as a result of the Enlightenment shift that occurred in the 17th and 18th centuries, theology in Western Europe and America shifted in the 19th century, rejecting literal interpretation and original intent of the authors, and replaced it with modern man's ideas, assuming that modern man knew more, understood more, and could interpret things better than the original authors. This didn't affect only theology. It affected things across the board, including the interpretation of law. Last week, when we talked about this, I did not have this quote last week. Somebody emailed it to me, and I've used it during the week. Justice Clarence Thomas, in a speech a week ago Thursday, said, let me put it this way, there are really only two ways to interpret the Constitution. Try to discern at best what we can, what the framers intended, or make it up. Now, that's the same issue in biblical hermeneutics. It's the same issue across the board. Is you read your real estate contract, you read your contract with your credit card company, do you interpret it as they intended, or do you just make it up? So we almost intuitively realize that original intent is significant. But then there's a second quote there, which someone sent me this last week, and I checked it out, that back in July, on July 17th, addressing a Planned Parenthood conference, Senator Obama addressed the Supreme Court's recent decision, Gonzalez versus Carhart, which upheld a ban on partial birth abortion. And in that speech, he said, the Constitution can be interpreted in so many ways. See the contrast? Thomas says interpretations based on original intent. Obama says it can be interpreted so many ways, just like liberal theologians think, oh, you can interpret the Bible all kinds of different ways. There is a connection between politics and liberal politics, liberalism in politics and liberalism in theology. And he went on to say, we need somebody who's got the heart, the empathy to recognize what it's like to be a young teenage mom, the empathy to understand what it's like to be poor or African American or gay or disabled or old, and that's the criteria by which I'm going to be selecting my judges. So the criteria isn't legal education and ability to understand the law in terms of its original intent, but feeling. So that emotion, feeling, and empathy now becomes the criteria for him for interpreting law. Let me put this in terms of theology. This is the political equivalent to trading in your Scofield Reference Bible or Ryrie Study Bible for a Joel Osteen Bible. Feeling and emotion become the criterion rather than what the text says. So we moved on from there to look at the basic criteria that we should have, which was embedded in the thinking of the founding fathers. And that comes from a doctrine we've studied many times called the divine institutions. And the divine institutions provide a framework for thinking about society and culture and making decisions. And whenever you make a decision, you go into the voting booth and you select a candidate. You are making a determination that this person or that person is good, better, best, or the other person perhaps is bad or worse. And so you make these value judgments. And whenever you make a value judgment, you're assuming that there is an external standard by which you can evaluate a candidate's positions and their beliefs. If you're going to say this person is better or that person is worse, you have to have some sort of guideline. And the scripture says that it is the only guideline, the only framework for a believer to use in evaluating anything in life. It starts, while the Bible is not a political science textbook, there are crucial passages in the scripture that address political theory. It's not an economic textbook there, but there are crucial things in the scripture that have been understood throughout the years to make certain economic assertions and implications. And these have been systematized and understood in terms of this category of the divine institutions. And so we begin to look at those. So let's just make a couple of observations by way of review. That the term divine institution has been used by Christians, by theologians, to speak of absolute social structures established by God and embedded within the social structure of the human race from its inception. Thus, these are for the entire human race, believers and unbelievers alike. They are unbreakable realities. Once you go in and try to start changing these things, that have all sorts of negative consequences. In contrast, modern paganism or human viewpoint thinking views them as byproducts of man's psychosocial evolution and thinks of them as cultural conventions. Conventions can be changed, but institutions cannot be changed. And so these divine institutions are therefore embedded in the scripture. Now, as we look at these divine institutions, I pointed out that there are five. There's a sixth criterion, in case you're wondering, and that has to do with how any Gentile nation relates to the nation Israel, and I'll be addressing that as a subcategory related to the fifth divine institution when we get there on Tuesday night. So we have individual responsibility, marriage, and family, which are established before the fall. Now, that's very important to understand that prior to the fall, these three are established, so this is part of God's original intent for mankind before sin. Second, we have the establishment of two more divine institutions after the flood, government and judicial responsibilities delegated to man in the Noahic covenant, and then nations and the distinction of nations and national identities established after the Tower of Babel. The first three are pre-fall, and they are designed to promote productivity and advance civilization. When these three are working together in their most efficient way, then that society or culture is going to be advancing and is going to be productive. The second two, which come after the fall, are designed to restrain evil so that 1, 2, and 3 can function efficiently. Now, there's a real limitation there. There's, when you think of government and nations being designed to restrain evil so that individual responsibility, marriage, and family can be promoted and go forward. Now, the first divine institution we looked at Thursday night, its individual responsibility, comes out of God's initial mandates to Adam after he had created him, primarily Genesis 1:27-28 and Genesis 2:15 and 25. Genesis 1:27, God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So male and female are both equally in the image of God. Genesis 1:28, God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, rule over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." So here you have five mandates: be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and rule over basically all the creatures God set upon the earth. In Genesis 2:15, God places Adam in the garden to tend and keep it. And the word to tend is the Hebrew word to work. And the word for keep is a Hebrew word, shamar, which means to keep or to protect or to guard. And I believe that the idea here is he had work to do to serve the Lord. It's not laborious. See, a lot of people just stumble over this because they can't. They think that Adam sat in the garden and twiddled his thumbs until he sinned. But that's not what happened. He had responsibilities to carry out, and this is a foundation for the doctrine of responsible labor. And labor, though, in a post-fall environment, we just can't get the past the idea in our little experience-oriented brains that work is laborious and that labor is toilsome. But before the fall, labor was not toilsome and work was not hard.